Welcome to the Institute for Historical Studies workshop entitled Covarrubias' Crossings, Picturing the New Negro and the Making of Modern Mexico. This workshop is part of the Institute's new program that centers on the work of 9 junior and advanced graduate student fellows from the History Department at the University of Texas. During each workshop, our graduate students will be in conversation with 3 scholars, or in this case, 4 scholars, who will engage with and critique their work. And at the end of the school year, the fellows will submit their essays to scholarly publications or fellowships in their field. The graduate student whose work we will be highlighting today is Rodrigo Salido Moulinié. Rodrigo is a writer, photographer, and doctoral student in the Department of History here at UT Austin, where he is a Fulbright Garcia Robles scholar and a context doctoral fellow. His work explores the interconnections between the histories of photography, science, and anthropology. So today we have 4 respondents. The first is Dr. Ruben Flores, Associate Professor of History at the University of Rochester. He is the author of Backroads Pragmatists, Mexico's Melting Pot and Civil Rights in the United States, and is an intellectual and cultural historian of the US and Mexico, who studies social reform movements and the use of university and government institutions as tools for creating social consensus. We are also joined by Dr. Adela Pinedo Franco, who is the Lozano Long Endowed Professor in Latin American Literary and Cultural Studies and the director of the Teresa Lozano Long Institute of Latin American Studies at the University of Texas at Austin. Prior to joining UT, she was professor of Latin American literature and film at Boston University, where she also founded the Center of Latin American Studies. Dr. Pineda Franco's latest book is The Mexican Revolution on the World Stage, Intellectuals in Film in the 20th Century. We're also joined by Dr. Peniel E. Joseph, who holds a joint professorship appointment at the LBJ School of Public Affairs and the History Department at the University of Texas at Austin. He is the founding director of the LBJ School's Center for the Study of Race and Democracy. Dr. Joseph's most recent book is The Sword and the Shield, The Revolutionary Lives of Malcolm X and Martin Luther King Jr., and he is also the author of the award-winning works Waiting Till the Midnight Hour, A Narrative History of Black Power in America, and Dark Days, Bright Nights, From Black Power to Barack Obama, and Stokely a Life. Lastly, we are joined by Dr. Mauricio Tenorio, the Samuel N. Harper Professor of History, Romance Languages, and Literatures at the University of Chicago. His work focuses on the cultural and social history of Mexican urbanism. He is the author, most recently, of I Speak of the City, Mexico City at the Turn of the 20th Century, Latin America, the Allure and Power of an Idea, and Clio's Laws on History and Language. I will pass it over to Dr. Canizares to get us started.
Thank you. Thank you, Ashley. The person who just introduced us all is Ashley Garcia. She is a doctoral student, fifth year doctoral student in our Department of History at UT, and she does the history of utopian socialism in the Northeast Coast in the 19th century. Well, it's really a pleasure to have all 4 of our distinguished readers, panelists, and Rodrigo. I really appreciate how quickly and willingly you accepted the invitation and within a week or less produced a thoughtful report on Rodrigo's essay. So thank you. We have tried to imitate the process of peer review and anonymous peer review in this exercise, this pedagogical lab. But we have reduced a process that usually takes 4-5 months into a week or 2. So I really appreciate the help of scholars, distinguished scholars like you, in these experiment. Rodrigo is our 7th student, and next week we'll have our 8th student and final student in this process. one per week since the beginning of the semester. So it's been a grueling exercise for me and for Ashley and Courtney. As part of this exercise, we also do a podcast. So I would like to share the podcast. I don't have access to sharing a screen, Courtney, again, in any way. I wanted to share, it was working a minute ago, but it's not working.
Let's see. So give it a try once more, maybe.
Okay. So this is the podcast with Ruben, Mexico Social Science Laboratory and the Origins of the U.S. Civil Rights Movement, based on his book, Roadside Pragmatists, a very important book, in my opinion, and it's a wonderful conversation we have with Rodrigo and Ruben, so you are all invited to listen to this podcast, and it's very relevant to our conversation today, definitely. So these are the rules of the game. Rodrigo has about 10 minutes to address the main points of all the reports, the referee reports, and my comments as well. After that, each one of the readers will have 3-5 minutes to clarify their ideas or offer further advice. And then after that, after each one has an opportunity to speak and further explore certain issues about Rodrigo's paper, we'll open up this to a conversation among all panelists and a Q&A. So if the audience, and we have 44 participants, that is wonderful. If the audience has questions, you can put them on the Q&A section and so we'll engage in a conversation with the panelists. The idea is for them to really use as much as possible the expertise of the panelists. That is the idea behind it. So that is why we kind of control the Q&A a little bit to give our panelists the opportunity to speak and further develop their ideas. So Rodrigo, you have 10 minutes.
Thank you, Professor Cañizares. Well, hello, everyone. I would like to first thank the 4 generous reviewers that agreed to read my work and write about it in a very limited time frame, Dr. Ruben Flores, Adela Pineda, Penel Joseph, and Mauricio Tenorio. And I would also like to thank Professor Cañizares, Ashley Garcia, and Courtney Miller for, it's because of them that all of this is possible. So this has been a great experience, so I'm very thankful. I will begin with a very brief introduction to the project, and then I will address 4 of the main topics that emerge from the reader's reports. First, I'm gonna talk about the paper's flawed structure or narrative. Second, the unstated theoretical framework that is guiding my analysis. Third, I will talk about my apparent reluctance to read the images and talk about the images. And finally, a little about the role of Covarrubias himself in my project. So first, I have to confess that I came to this project almost by accident. I stumbled upon this large set of echoes and connections while looking for something else, while trying to show the importance of photography in the making of social sciences in Mexico, the United States, and abroad, especially anthropology. I ended up looking into a much more interesting world that includes art, music, anthropology, and the politics of representation. I was trained as a political scientist, and I am still recovering from that experience. So finding a voice to say something about all these worlds has been a very challenging but encouraging experience. Covarrubias has become for me a wonderful guide to navigate these new worlds that I stumbled upon. The more I try to step back and look into the broader picture, the more he came back. He pops up everywhere, and he did so much stuff that I just came across with him hundreds of times. So his life was truly interesting, and I chose him precisely because he refused to use photographs in his work. His work was different somehow. It was going against the grain of most of the artistic and anthropological trends of the time. But yet that initial impulse that drove me to his life remains there. the ways we represent, the styles and techniques we use, those are all political choices. They have real deep implications beyond the scholarly world, and I suspect that Covarrubias did it for a reason. So what I initially tried to say was that Covarrubias did this intentionally to try to show something else, and this is where my language gets very sketchy. He tried to show the essence, the soul, the something undescribable and untraceable that photographs completely miss. But those are for now empty words that I'm hoping my research will fill. So now I'll talk about the comments of my paper. First, I'm going to talk about the structure. This is something Professor Butler and Professor Del Castillo pointed out to me the first time they read the early draft of this essay. And I think this organization reflects two things. On the one hand, that I am learning and exploring these worlds while I'm writing about them. And the second one is that I'm trying to argue more than one thing, which is what makes the paper kind of a mess. On the one hand, I want to say that Covarrubias and his work made the Du Bois Locke debate on art and propaganda very explicit, and that Covarrubias is a great window to talk about that debate. But on the other hand, I want to say that Mexico, as this large wave of modernism, shaped the Harlem Renaissance. And a third hand, which is a part of the project I have not done research on, is to explore how this experience shaped Mexico in the 1940s to the 1960s. The practical problem is that when I try to use section 3 as the core of the paper, I find myself writing about these little journals, Crisis, Opportunity, Surveygraphic, and Covarrubias there without really explaining how important they were. And I think that is what makes my argument a little stronger, that these were very important publications, and the fact that Covarrubias' work is being debated there is kind of what makes it for me extremely relevant. So I have to kind of reorganize that to accomplish those two goals. The second issue is my lack or unexplicit theoretical framework. It's been a little hard for me to shake off the previous intentions of the paper I talked about earlier, and really let my sources and the evidence I've been finding to shape the theory I'm going to use. I know I needed an interdisciplinary approach because these people were interdisciplinary. I need a transnational approach because these people and these ideas were also transnational. And I need something that crosses images, texts, scientific reports, travelogues, ethnographies, because those are the echoes I have of the languages they were speaking. I love the suggestions that I should use Hughes's poem and the rivers as a theoretical framework, as an anchor for my analysis, but I have to work a lot on that. But I think it's a wonderful idea. And part of my missing framework is my understanding of what the state is, which maybe I should get rid of, but I just wanted to make clear that I kind of unconsciously adopted the approaches of Philip Abrams, Sekul Gupta, Timothy Mitchell, who work or argue that the state is much more than the buildings and organizations and institutions that keep it running. It's the images, the illusion of the state, the idea of the state that shapes behaviors, shapes art, and a lot of things. But that is not explicit in my paper, and I recognize that makes it a little sketching how I use the word state, modern Mexico, as almost equivalent things. But this brings me to the third issue of this paper, which is my apparent reluctance to read the images myself and talk about them myself. I hope this doesn't sound as an excuse, although I'm afraid it is. But this reluctance comes from an insecurity grounded on positionality. This is a very blunt way to put it, and I know there are smart ways to read them and to talk about them. But I've been struggling to say that an image dignifies someone without implying she wasn't beforehand, or that an image is less distorting than the other one. How can I say that Covarrubias was making a political argument against science and against the visual culture of anthropology without ventriloquizing Covarrubias or his subjects? As I said, this is a very blunt way to put it, and I know there is a smart way to do that. I had to write a history of those images, what they meant then, their origins, their connections, and not only a personal essay on their political implications, but I'm still working on finding that voice. And finally, a fourth issue that emerged is that I realized after days after sending this draft that Covarrubias never speaks in my article. I've been kind of tracing the receptions of his work, how people interpreted him, but I do not offer not even a sketch of his biography or his life. And he wrote a lot. He wrote books, did interviews, he wrote articles, a couple of conferences, and I never let him speak. Although his works are a little descriptive, he rarely lets an opinion or a reflection escape him, but there are those fragments that I could use, and I just failed to use them. And I think this could also be remedied with an explicit, more coherent theoretical framework that would kind of round up this article. I wanted to thank you all again for your time, and this has been a great experience to have all your insightful comments of this paper. I would leave it there for now.
Thank you, Rodrigo. So now we'll have our panelists in the following order: Ruben, Professor Flores first. Then we'll have Professor Joseph, and then Professor Pineda Franco, and finally Professor Tenorio. And welcome back, Professor Tenorio, who taught at UT for a while. So it's really a pleasure to have you back. So Ruben, you are first.
Okay.
You have about 3-5 minutes. So.
Oh, okay. Sounds good. I'll do this pretty quickly here. Thank you to IHS, yeah, Rodrigo, muchas gracias, and Jorge for the chance to read this. I agree with others in the readers' reports that this is a very insightful sort of moment that you describe, that actual reading that you do in part three. Let me leave aside the question of what the content of the conversation should be over the drawings, and just say that I'm convinced by what you have done here that there is enough substance in that conversation, the conversation between Du Bois, Locke, and Covarrubias. You bring in other intellectuals, but I am convinced that because of their political reaction to what is playing before them, the drawings themselves, that there is enough content here that you can carry the project out fruitfully. For me, it was precisely because I think there is something there to dig out more, but because I'm already convinced that it's there, that part three works very, very well. I like it as a larger statement about the US and Mexico because Americanists tend to forget the period between 1900 and about 1920 or 1930 as a moment when many different cultural groups were rethinking cultural nationalism. So it wasn't just Blacks, both in the South and in the urban North, but it was also Jewish Americans who were, Horace Kalin, for example, is a very prominent example. And then white Protestant Americans like Randolph Bourne, also New York City based. Alain Locke had a fruitful relationship with both of these individuals. We tend to forget 1900 to 1930 as a fruitful moment for these kinds of conversations. And so what you're doing is actually bringing attention to an earlier moment that is important to theorize beyond sort of post-1945. I agree with you, however, that the narrative structure of the paper doesn't work. Parts one and two are not integrated into the narrative structure of that part of the paper that for me works best, which is definitely part three. You hardly mention Covarrubias at all in the first two pages, in the first two sections. And I think you're exactly right that you need more biography there. I especially would like to see more institutional nodes. There are times when you talk about him as an anthropologist. on the other hand, you talk about him as having merely anthropological sensibilities. I'm not exactly sure what you mean by that. And then there are times when you talk about visual anthropology as well. You just said in your opening that he had disagreements with anthropology. So I want to know more about his relationship to these institutional nodes in Mexico. And part of it would be to learn more about his training in particular, the act of representation, and how he arrives at the representations that he takes to New York. These institutional nodes are important because they're going to convert what you currently have from a history of the drawings themselves, a history of the object. I mean, the semiotics of the object are there, but we need a political and a social history of the US and Mexico writ large. And if these institutional nodes are missing, we don't quite get that. We don't get it at all. I'd also like to know more about that early cadre of Americanists, how you see them fitting into the storyline. If not, you can just jettison them. And clearly, Covarrubias was providing artistic representations for others as well. But after you mention them at the beginning of the paper, they never come back. And so what their relationship to the story is, I'm not exactly clear. I have a couple of other points, but let me leave it for now, and we'll move on so that others can join the discussion. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Ruben. And now it's Professor Pineda Franco's turn. Welcome, Adela, to the directorship of LILAS. It's a pleasure to have you on campus and also as a colleague. And so when we were planning this event, you were at the top of the possible reviewers, given your background on the history of modernism, both in the United States and Mexico. So this is right on your alley. So Adela, welcome.
Thank you so much, Jorge. This is actually the first kind of like intellectual project I am doing as director, and I am very happy to be contributing to Rodrigo with some insights into his work. I'm very happy to see all of you, meet you a few, and see Mauricio, whom is a longtime colleague. I appreciate deeply. So Rodrigo, first of all, congratulations. I love the topic. As I said, it's a fabulous topic. In my own research, I always thought that nationalism, Mexican nationalism, is not nationally, it's a transnational enterprise. It is like the window of modernity in the 20th century. And I also think that it's not only a project of the state, it's a project of the intellectual class and of the artists, of writers, in Mexico and abroad, that had this moment of envisioning the idea of a nation, but also how they kind of like weaved other genealogies. And this one in particular that you are bringing forward is particularly interesting in our moment today, you know, like revisit African-American history and the importance of the Harlem Renaissance. So in that said, I think the project should be major, it's important. And I agree totally with Professor Flores, Ruben, if I may say, that the paper is a little bit disorganized. I wouldn't say disorganized, but it lacks focus. It's very hard for the reader to know if it's a text on Covarrubias, a text on reception, a text on the weight of images in interpreting ideas. You know, there are several possibilities, and you give wonderful suggestions. You use materials that are in themselves very rich. And my point, as a literary scholar and a film scholar, my point in taking your literary and visual sources in a more kind of like careful way, it has to do not that you should think as a literary theory, expert, but how are they useful or instrumental for historiographical research? And so that you can go beyond the level of description, right? So when I thought about the poem was like there, a poem brings the difficulty in kind of like bringing together abstract universe of space. That's what poems and images create. Spaces that have several locations that are abstract and that are mindful, and then anecdotes, you know, the fact of writing a poem in a train that goes to Mexico. So you have those two levels always when you are dealing with sources. So how can you build up a framework of reference of what you want to do there? How can you use these materials in a more analytical way and not just anecdotal, not just as a grabber of attention? I don't want you to read images, but I thought that it's interesting how Covarrubias, how images were perceived. And this is why I think your study is more a study in reception. How images that are considered caricatures trigger debates on ideas of race, of liberation, of new individuals. Covarrubias himself, and you quote him, says that he didn't consider his drawing caricatures. And that's very interesting because you are reaching there the level of images as referential and metaphorical. Metaphorical images always trigger multiple interpretations. And that's what you are seeing in your own research, in your own archival research on how these images were perceived. Like when you cite a short story, the level of ambiguity there has to do with the obscure meanings that the story has. It's irony, right? It's clear. I thought that it was very interesting how Hughes was actually looking into the way Covarrubias was consumed, not only debated, but this is the moment when images are also triggering a consumerist society, and why consumer society is going to be so important for these movements at large as well. You know, like if we think about the press, Alfred Knopf, like the projects of the books that they were publishing or translating and how they were translating certain works. You know, like if you see the way the eagle and the serpent was translated in a way to make it really more accessible to a general readership. You know, so Covarrubias is there, is there to create also an image of the new Negro that has to do with wider readerships. And this is why it brought so much conflict between these African-American intellectuals, no? So these are the things that I consider important. Also, when you talk about definitions, like what is representation? You throw very general ideas, and these ideas are border crossings, you know, like these words, like when you do that, it's very important that you revisit those definitions with more rigor. What do you mean by, you know, crossing or border? You know, just like try to bring your definition in a more humble way. I always think that when we go to very specific ways of defining concepts, then you can enlarge them, and then they make sense. So this is basically what I can tell you in general terms, but I do think that I appreciate your project. I would recommend that article that precedes your chapter that was published in this book, Open Borders to a Revolution. There is a book that has been controversial recently because the, you know, historians think is not very rigorous in terms of historiographical research, but it's very interesting conceptually. It's called Culture and Revolution by Horacio Legras. And he makes a point that's very interesting about the use of culture and images. Yeah, see, Mauricio hates it. But I think one of the ideas of that book is why intellectuals envision something that was bigger than the prospect of the state. Why their projects like went beyond that, no? And so that's why I think this book is interesting, although Mauricio is making faces to me. But that's all what I can say for now, and congratulations.
Thanks, Adela. Joseph will take over. He has 3 to 5 minutes as well. We are very happy that he accepted our invitation, and and looks at this from the perspective more of the Harlem Renaissance and African American intellectual history. So thanks, Peniel. Your turn.
I thought it was a fantastic paper, Rodrigo. So my comments are just about taking it to the next level. The book that I'd like you to read is, if you could read just one single book, and I have a lot of different recommendations, is this book here called The Indignant Generation. I would like to see you write a book like this. But my colleague and friend, Lawrence Jackson, who's at Johns Hopkins, is one of the best writers in the country, and irrespective of any discipline. And this book is really a magnum opus about not just Black writers between 1934 and 1960. This book looks at Black and white, and at times Latinx and European writers as well, who were part of this transnational diasporic Harlem Renaissance in that sense. And what I'd like you to do here is turn your main protagonist, instead of just Miguel, turn him into that historical epic and context of modernist Mexico, and then bridge that with the Harlem Renaissance. What this is, and it's The Indignant Generation, the subtitle is A Narrative History of African-American Writers and Critics, 1934 to 1960. It's really even more than that. It's a tour de force of intellectual, political, social, cultural history over this 25-year period, and looks at the way in which we go from sort of the radical social realism of the 1930s and 40s, and people like Ann Petrie, The Street, and Richard Wright, into the Ralph Ellison and really early James Baldwin, which is not middle and later James Baldwin, this sort of Cold War neoliberal perspective of sort of colorblindness and universality, even though there's no context to get that universality, right? And it shows you that, but it also shows you what the critics are saying. So you get Buckland Moon, you get a young Sidney Hook, you get your whole piece here when you talk about the Marxist and the communist and the socialist and the Trotskyist. This is all there in The Indignant Generation. I thought one of the best aspects of what you're doing here is making us rethink Langston Hughes. And I said, you got to read the Rampersad, the two volumes, because Hughes is ripe for rethinking. And I love how you talk about what he's thinking and how Mexico shaped Langston Hughes. That is brilliant. You talk about Elaine Locke. The other book I'd like you to get, and we're going to bring in here the center, Jeffrey Stewart's book. This is 932 pages, but it's worth the read. And this came out in 2018. I've got the hardcover because I read it as soon as it came out. But this is a tour de force of not just Elaine Locke, and he won the Pulitzer Prize and National Book Award, but this is a serious piece of scholarship that's well-written as well. He spent about 40 years working on that. It was his dissertation in 1976 that he turned into a Pulitzer Prize. And so that's real commitment, spending 40 years working on one project. And again, it's a 1,000-page project. It's amazing. But the Elaine Locke that you have here, I'd like you to see, I'd like you to read this and flush out that Elaine Locke, because I think you're right. Elaine Locke is very serious. And what he shows here, Elaine Locke goes to Egypt. He goes all over the world, right? Searching, right, for this idea of race and culture. So my final deal, Rodrigo, is that you've got like the bones here of a major groundbreaking piece of scholarship that goes beyond like what people usually expect for a first book. And it's about like just putting it all together, right? And making that happen. So this is something that you work on. It's a terrific, I love the pictures. So you also have an art history. One thing, Rodrigo, read Louis Menin's The Free World. The Free World, read that. That's a 800 page tour de force about art. And he leaves so many gaps for you because you have Mexico down, right? And you're taking Mexico and Afro-America seriously. So this is amazing. And I just would encourage you that this is going to be hugely exciting by the time this comes out as just a major blockbuster. So, you know, kudos.
Thank you. Peniel, now Professor Tenorio, your turn, 5 minutes.
Well, I'm not going to repeat what has already been said. You know my opinion. Put it as elegantly as you can, but and do whatever you want, but read the images. Don't mess around with me. If you're going to use images, read them. Don't hedge around and be, you know, picky about it. And, you know, one thing is you don't know how to do it. Well, that's one thing, but the idea that you are using images and you what? Leave it there so that what? So read it. You need context, of course. You need to read more. You need to see more. You need to understand more. Well, do it. You have there the contrast of some cartoons by Covarrubias, and then the beautiful paintings also by this German Ries. And so you have to read them. If not, don't use them. Second, I told you several times that you have to take seriously the debate, Alan Locke and everything. And maybe, as I told you several times, his own position versus miscegenation and mestizaje, it's very important. You only focus on one book by Locke, on one or two comments by Du Bois. Read the entire thing and the opposition and his own position versus what is happening in Mexico and in Egypt and in France, his position when he was in Oxford. I asked you to do that and I didn't see it here. In order to bridge from the images of Covarrubias and his input on creating a reality that becomes anthropological, you need to read Covarrubias himself. I don't know why you haven't seen whether in the NOF archive there are letters by Covarrubias. I don't know why you haven't seen the UTLA archive of Covarrubias. I missed many of the references of works by Covarrubias, like exhibitions and catalogs in which experts talk about them. So a little bit more on that will be very important to make it into a self-contained piece, or what I hope it be a larger project, including other things, you know, Mexican folkways, anthropologies, et cetera, but you need to look. And finally, there is a missing part of the argument, because as Professora Pineda tells you, and I told you openly, because I know you don't take offense or whatever I say, and even if I do, I don't think I will stop saying it. You are looking for sound bites, and that's good. It's our tendency if we want our provincialized in Europe as soon as possible, if in our career, so that we sell in all books and we become famous. But maybe it's too early in your career to look for the sound bite. So go for the clear thing. And don't exaggerate what you are finding, what you are trying to do. Some of the phrases are very beautiful, but they are not yet proven. It's too early to say so strongly about crossings and about borders and about the importance of the Harlem as a fundamental part for them. It's just too early in the research. And I told you about the Mexican part of the whole thing also. You need to see the Harlem and Covarrubias, you didn't see anything else on Hughes. I told you about Toluca. I told you about the father. I told you about the other poems. I told you about Anastrosa. I told you about Cartier de Bergson and him in Mexico. Before and after, African Americans that are present in Mexico. You have the example of Jack Johnson, Elizabeth Cattle is one of the African American painters that was to study with with Diego Rivera and Stays in Mexico, not even mention of it. I told you about Caroline de Root and the images of Indians and African Americans in New Orleans and this. And above all, you have to see also there are contradictions. I think that if you explore more of the Harlem Renaissance, you are going to sooner or later get into the communist problem, which is many of these African Americans were communist and were not precisely close or liked Du Bois or the other. And thus Mexico was important for them because some were close to Trotsky or to Rivera. Once you get there, you are going to also face the problem of the international communist and what did they do in Mexico and the state. Some are the same characters, as you know. Some of these Mexican envoys were Americans, American Jews, or Indians from India. Careful with that. And there, I think that you have to face with the reception of these in Mexico. And Covarrubias is not all. The most important reception is foxtrot, jazz, and blues in Mexico. And I told you, Rodrigo, about the musical reviews and how people start to talk, this is black music, we shouldn't corrupt ourselves, we shouldn't do this, we shouldn't do that. What is Carlos Chavez nationalism doing with this music? Why is he rejecting this and going to all the way to pre-Hispanic music? And there is a strong rejection to this black music. On the other, there is a great fascination. And so there is a reception of this, which is also anthropological, at some points, I don't know. I have given you. We talk about this many times. So I hope that it's a matter that is going to be part of the big project. It will be very difficult to put all these things together in a 30-page paper. But I hope you do, because the project is very, very provocative, very interesting. You were able to put together will be wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you, Mauricio. Well, my take on your paper is, it's evolving. It's been evolving since we first began to talk about Covarrubias and anthropology and photography, et cetera, et cetera. And so, I have no doubt that you look into the sources and extract from all of them a meaningful narrative. As is right now, it is messy. But again, it's the reflection of a process of investigation and digging deeper and deeper. My concern is. Well, there are many concerns. One is the historiography. I mean, you are not the first to have noticed these connections between the Harlem Renaissance and Mexican, and Covarrubias and Mexican muralism, et cetera, et cetera. What is it you are contributing? It's not entirely clear. As I read your paper and then did my own research on Covarrubias and the Harlem Renaissance, I began to find all sorts of individuals who have been working on this subject that are not in the paper and they are not at the forefront. And so you need to acknowledge that and draw distinctions. And what are the main arguments? It's the framing and the historiographical stakes that are not entirely clear. The idea of a new Negro is not new, of course, and so the role of art in the creation of these political cultural statement and movement is not new. What seems to be new, well, and it's not that new either, is that you are connecting it to the emergence of a new Mexican. It's actually a new mestizo type of discourse. New mestizo Mexico or Mexican, and so is this connecting that needs to be clearer, and how these two things are in a dialogue. They are clearly in a dialogue through muralism. So the fact that you are kind of foregrounding Covarrubias in and of itself is problematic to me because there are so many people here at play, and that also obscures the chronology, because Covarrubias, it would appear as if Covarrubias is creating all these ideas, but the new Negro movement begins in 1920, 1921, and Covarrubias coming of age in 1926. And actually many of his images come from the 1930s. I mean, the uncle's Tom Cabin, the other images that you discuss in the paper are in the 1930s and late 1930s for that. So Covarrubias is coming late to many of these issues. And so what is attractive to Covarrubias is this language of illustration that is also in all muralism. It's not only in Covarrubias. And Covarrubias is in this debate on the new Negro. It's a very controversial figure, it seems to me, at the time, and for good reason. So I wanted to share some of the things that I was looking into when I was reading your paper. And so this image that is not discussed in the paper, as Professor Tenorio insists, it's rather provocative in more ways than one. It's the title, Enter the New Negro, a Distinctive Type Recently, Exit. So after you have this ideology of a new Negro that has to rethink the representations of Blacks in African Americans in white supremacist United States that are particularly demeaning through the blackface, minstrels, and so on and so forth, and race, and all sorts of craniometry, et cetera, et cetera. And so people like Du Bois and Hughes and others and Locke are kind of fighting against this construct by creating new representations. And here you have Covarrubias 1926 saying this, enter the new Negro and exit the cotton picker, the mummy singer. I mean, that is so, I don't know how to put it. It's not provocative, it's insulting, at least the title. And then you have all these images in the Negro drawings that are kind of in between illustration but also cartoon, notwithstanding what he has to say about illustrations. And it was controversial. Look at the hands of this guy, the so-called dancing couple, and so on and so forth. So then there are the illustrations of 1928 Adventures of African Slaver. I don't remember the name of the author. So it's a 18th century text that has these illustrations by Covarrubias. They are all indeed kind of undermining some of the text, but there is this ethnography to it. Look at the hammock and the Black women on the hammock. All these ethnographic elements to the illustrations that are on the one hand fascinating, and it's part of this ethnography of the time, but also deeply problematic in many ways than one. And then there is the handy blues. Well, the handy blues that you mentioned, but I wanted to dwell more on these illustrations that were caused Du Bois to produce an extraordinarily critical review of Born to Be by this 36-year-old individual who pretends to do an autobiography and memoir when he's 36. Causing these singer of blues or spirituals, Taylor Gordon, and his life, of course. And so here you have Covarrubias illustrating the book, and he's addressed to this Carl Van Vechten, right? That is, I think he's the character that this collector of things Black, this white collector of things Black, that Hughes addresses in his piece on chattel slavery and the new modern chattel slavery of the collector. All these images are fascinating in and of themselves, but they are all sorts of references to precisely the type of images that Du Bois is trying to undermine. And here you have Covarrubias insisting on that type of representation, including the watermelons that you referred to in the opera staging that Covarrubias designed. And finally, there are all these, I mean, there is a lack of greater context on who Covarrubias is and what he's doing in New York and for whom he's working. There are dozens of illustrations in Vanity Fair of this guy that are part of who he is and what he's doing. And they are missing in kind of the context and the background of what you do. There are also the tons of illustrations. He's an illustrator of all these publishers in New York, including these John Huston, Frankie, and Johnny's images of 1926. But what I said before is this is Slave on the Block by Langston Hughes that you refer in passing, which is a searing critique of the white collector in New York that is collecting Covarrubias, but is collecting people, and is collecting Blacks, and is collecting literature, and is collecting Blacks artists and maids as types. It's a devastating critique of the types of people that Covarrubias was working with. So I want to stop there, but there is a context here that is missing, and this it's overemphasis on Covarrubias that doesn't allow you to see the wider issues here that seem to be happening, the role of Mexico in the creation of these new social science, anthropology, the forging of identities, et cetera. In any event, I am done now. This is the moment in which the audience steps in and the panelists also should feel free to say whatever they want to say in a conversation. So this is an open conversation now. So if you want to react to what the panelists said and Rodrigo, and this is an invitation, open invitation to the audience to ask questions.
Jorge, can I ask one quick question?
Yes.
Rodrigo, did you ever use any of the work of the contemporaneos in Mexico as a foil for thinking about representations of, you know, the new Mexicano in post-revolutionary Mexico as a way of thinking a little bit deeper about Covarrubias' own aesthetic and his own definition of what the new Mexicano should be? I mean, I was struck by that there are these constituencies in Mexico, including that one, for example, but it seems like it's a possible way to unearth and excavate a particular dialogue that he might be having with these New Yorkers.
Yes, well, I haven't, and I mean, maybe the reason in part is what Professor Tenorio pointed, that this kind of new dimension of the Mexican connection is somehow just coming into my article, and in part is because I was kind of, not convinced, but I was kind of aware that Covarrubias is somehow not forgotten, but there's it's kind of hard to get his impression and his footsteps in Mexico. It's been a little hard for me to find reviews, find the copies of his books, everything. I think it's only a reflection of his big success in the United States and how all his work was kind of, most of his work was kind of thought of for that audience United States, which is why I think Covarrubias, I mean, I know I focus too much on him and I should let him go, but I think he's just the perfect point in a very broad network that connects all these things that I'm interested in. He's somehow absorbing Franz Boas' theories through Sora Neale Hurston and through his New York friends, and Carlos Chavez is also very interested in that. And I learned that from the article Professor Pineda recommended that I read, and I'm sorry I failed to cite it. But Covarrubias is this connection between this big Mexican modernist wave that is influencing New York, and then he also is my connection to Mexico in the 1930s, 1940s. Why is he kind of hard to find in my very little knowledge of the Mexican sources is one of the main problems for me. And I did a very preliminary trip to Cholula, to the Universidad de las Americas, to his archive. I don't know if this will hurt me to say it, but I kind of dig through his papers, and it was my first archival experience. And I will confess it was a little puzzling to find a correspondence of a very broad bunch of people that I at the time didn't know who they were. I hadn't done enough readings and research to kind of make those connections in the archive and use the archive as the guiding source of my work. And it's, I think now I'm ready to do that trip and to kind of complete that research that Professor Tagnario showed me and is guiding me through in the last few months. And I think this also points to something Dr. Flores said about this very sketchy way of using anthropologists and person with anthropological tendencies or sensibilities. And I think it's just another reflection of this research that I have to do, which is how did he learn all this stuff? He was self-taught in a lot of ways, but all these networks and all these people were kind of learning from each other. And I mean, he wrote ethnography, successful ethnographies. He taught at the Escuela Nacional, but he never went to college. He never got a degree of any sort. He never, so it's this ambivalence of practitioners, theorists, the institutional history of the University of Colombia, the School of Anthropology in Mexico, the Escuela Nacional de Antropología. It is, I agree that this institutional history is completely absent in my work, and I should explore it more.
We have Professor Garrard ask a question. It strikes me that Covarrubias and his work are really more representative of Mexicanidad, the Mexicanized new acceptable Negro in the US, both an icon of the mid-19th century vocal things Mexican and the safer boundaries of the Harlem Renaissance jazz cues, but not communism or meaningful radicalism, just as the real radicals of the Mexican Revolution were not as accepted as the more palatable Mexican artists and writers. I'm thinking in particular of the strange incongruence of the commissioning of the Covarrubias mural in Dallas, of all places, in 1954 on the wall of the title company. This is a city where the White Citizens Council still reigned supreme. Segregation was a fact of life, and Mexicans were also denied basic dignities. Response?
Yes, well, I have stumbled upon the problem Professor Tenorio also mentioned, which is this communism, Marxism, kind of workers imagery in the 1920s, 1930s, and Covarrubias has like a very vague position towards it. I mean, as Professor Garrard said, he has this ambivalent position. He's working for private companies in New York. He's illustrating, he's picturing celebrities for Vanity Fair. And at the same time, he has these communist friends in Mexico who kind of, I guess, saw him last as a white fresa in the United States. And then he starts to radicalize a little bit in the 1930s and 1940s with this Orientalist wave in Mexico. He starts to look to China and goes to China a couple of times and illustrates Pearl Buck's translation of All Men Are Brothers. And he is fascinated by the country, and he learns the language. And I think that's one of the sources of his later political convictions, that he was a kind of a sympathizer of communism. I wouldn't call him a communist, but he was then banned from the United States for years, and that's when they, he and Rosa Rolando, his wife, moved back to Mexico. So this is like a whole new dimension that I haven't explored in detail, which of course should inform not only my reading of these social networks, but also the images, because these images were evolving through time with the kind of these different ideologies converging in Mexico and New York.
Maybe anyone, you wanted to say something?
No. We can go to the next one.
Professor Ravi says, I'm actually struck by the potential advantages of centering your story in Covarrubias as a way to trace out broader connections. While you did not emphasize biographical elements in this piece, can you speak a bit about your thoughts on the potential advantages and trade-offs of centering on an individual and their connections and travels?
Yes, I think that these advantages are very clear, and I think most of the comments made today kind of point to that weakness, that he's just a chapter. What I have is just a tiny chapter of a very big transnational history that I would like to explore and write about. And I think I was just, you know, on automatic pilot, just looking through the sources and finding out more about Covarrubias in New York, which has led me to this project, and I think to a lot of interesting things that I was completely unaware of before that. So he has been a great guide to come to this place, but I think there are major drawbacks of writing kind of biographical big projects. But I'm still convinced that I could kind of do it. I would love to do this kind of project, like Stuart's book, but on Covarrubias, because Covarrubias is just the example of a very big experience that I want to explore. So I think as one of the reviewers wrote, for this paper, I should focus more on him and kind of do as a standing piece, I should explore this biographical aspect in detail. And maybe, I mean, I'm sometimes worried that I would write the same biography every article about Covarrubias has. And yes, he arrived in New York with Tablada in 1923, and then he, like that same paragraph will appear in most of these pieces. But I think for the bigger project that I still have to write, which is the back and forth with Mexico during almost three decades, I would like to go beyond Covarrubias.
I would like to ask, Adela is going to intervene in a second, but I would like to ask our panelists of experts here, how would you advise Rodrigo to reorganize his essay around the life of Covarrubias, and particularly his take on Harlem? Well, there's many other things that he's doing in addition to Harlem, but that is as the running thread of the essay. Adela.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, that's a major question. I just wanted to comment first on the role of Rosa. I think it's very important, Rodrigo, that you look into the role of Rosa, because she was also kind of like a guiding figure in his intellectual pursuits. And that's, you can see that in the archives at UCLA. I also think that it's important to consider the way he gets to the United States, also through the mediation of Tablada, and to see that, like, these intellectuals like Tablada were not radicals at all, right? They had a very specific relationship with the revolution that was actually a very awkward one. They profited from the revolutionary culture, but they were anti-revolutionaries. And so, you know, one thing to consider is, like, what was the role of that platform? And this is when I consider that the cultural revolution is much bigger than the revolution itself. And then from there on, you can see, like, the different Covarrubias, right? The Valley trip really changes his perspective, and also his affiliations to socialist and communist ideas are going to evolve later. So this is something that you have to consider. If, just to answer Professor Cañizares' question, I really would take into account what Professor Joseph said, that it is a matter of bringing together two very different platforms into conversation and make or highlight the distinctive roles. Like Covarrubias is being subject to commentary inside a movement that was like developing very, very, very important ideas on the new Negro and the identity of African Americans at that moment, a generation that was particularly revolutionary. Covarrubias had a more cosmopolitan project at the time. And I think this is very important to consider the role of popular culture. This is why he chooses caricature and what type of circulation you know, these drawings have. So that's what I can say. I don't know.
Professor Tenorio has to leave, but before he leaves, I would like to ask him his parting words of advice for Rodrigo on how to pull this off, how to organize, regardless of the dissertation, just this essay on Covarrubias and Harlem.
Well, first I give you my bendish, but it's, I think it's possible to do a nice piece only based on the role that he plays in what you center, a little bit more on him, more voiced by him, some letters by him, the letters with Hughes, more personally reading the text that he has written and letters by Hughes, Locke, and the same focus you have, and only focus on that and getting out of the finishing the paper before with a simple but provocative essay of three or four pages saying what is he, how the Mexican Renaissance, as you use the Anita Brenner famous name, Mexican Renaissance is being made simultaneously by Harlem, and how Harlem is also being made by the Mexican Renaissance. It's not necessarily they are as connected as you want to be, as you want them to be, but they respond to the same trends. And in a way, they are also in connection via, for instance, the example of Covarrubias. And so with more of Covarrubias' voice, more of Locke, maybe focusing on the debates about the role of the Black intellectual and miscegenation and the images, within the images, and that could be good without now messing with the complicated problems of Mexico reception of the Harlem Renaissance via Covarrubias, because it will be just too much, but just the debate.
You said the Harlem and Mexico are responding to the same trends. What would those trends be, in your opinion?
To me, it's very clear. You know, first of all, it's the end of the Western world, and the sense that we are in a total crisis. The reinvention of the Western world, because after World War I and the whole thing. Second, the end of American progressivism in the classical sense, and now the beginning of a new search, which includes the search of the exotic. Even in Bali or Mexico or France or Sicilia, and Harlem is the backyard exotic aspect to do that. Third, the both the threat and the hope of communism and whatever the Soviet Revolution meant, which is making both scenarios. For the avant-garde who are making what was before impossible. Possible in all set of aesthetic and political terms. And third, the complicated business of race. But the problem with race is that the moment one starts to speak of race in English, as I always say, it inevitably becomes Alabama. So Rodrigo has to be careful to realize that there are not consensus, as he shows, among African Americans intellectuals about what to do with race and what is the future, and even Du Bois changes his mind too many times. So one has to be very careful. But race is a fundamental aspect of this discussion. Race understood, as Rodrigo shows, also as the emergence of cultural disciplines like anthropology that are going to be very important. Rodrigo mentions Mexico, but he could also have mentioned Santa Fe, New Mexico. He could also have mentioned France in Algeria, or he could also have mentioned the rediscovery of the Mayas in the epoch, the Maya architecture in the Pan American exhibition in San Francisco. I mean, it's everywhere. So those are the same current that are. And the interesting thing is that Mexico is providing something to the world gradually by trial and error. Nobody knows what it's going to be. That it becomes very successful in the long run. And Harlem too, but in different ways, but they are responding to the same aspects. And I do think that for people like Hughes, who experienced Mexico, or people like Locke, who also went to Mexico. Mexico is a model of something that is happening. They are very aware that Mexico is a laboratory of what they are doing. Not all Mexicans are aware that Harlem is a laboratory of what they are doing. But many are, and about Mexico in Harlem and in the United States. Many of them remember are Americans, it's full of Americans, not all African Americans, but are also in the interracial. It's funny how the, what is the name of this professor Flores, what is the name of this book about Protestant missionaries as?
Hollinger, David Hollinger.
Yes, that's
Protestants Abroad.
That's a very good book about how the children of these missionaries are incorporated, for instance, China, or are incorporated Africans from Africa. And they are at the avant-garde of the progressive, Pearl as a book. Who would have known that Pearl as a book was such a great fighter against racism in the United States, because she was the daughter of a missionaries in China. And these missionaries are in Mexico and are also integrating things. Then even you can go to the first movement of civil rights in California. It's integrated Filipinos, Mexicanos, and African Americans. But they are all with the Catholic mark. Think of the Perez. Professor Flores Perez versus anti-miscegenation laws, California, 1940.
Fort Mendez versus Westminster?
No, Perez versus what? Anti-miscegenation laws, the last anti-miscegenation laws in California.
Oh, this was like, well, the first one begins right about like 1908, 1909.
Perez wants to the help of this Catholic progressive civil rights movement in California. Perez wins the case in the Supreme Court. And what is the name? Look into a book by how's the name of this Professor Flores?
Peggy Pascoe.
What's the name of the book?
It's the Miscegenation. Yeah, it's, let me get the title here.
As Ruben looks for the title, you had, Mauricio, a couple of lines there about Locke, Hughes, and Du Bois, and miscegenation and mestizaje. Would you care to elaborate a little bit?
What comes naturally?
What comes naturally?
Yes.
You had in your notes references to Locke and Hughes and Du Bois and mestizaje and miscegenation.
I haven't studied that, but as you know, my passport it clearly states that I'm a Mexican and I'm not allowed to speak of race in the United States. And so I don't speak of race in the United States, especially not in English. So I speak in Spanish and I've been trying this. And I think it's very important because the miscegenation aspect, there is a strong miscegenation, pro-miscegenation, not strong, an important pro-miscegenation thinking in the United States, both black and white, but it's minority and it's very important. And I think for people like Covarrubias, imagine Covarrubias, you think he's exoticist and he's doing this kind of giving whites what they are hoping to find in his images, But he's very careful. He never puts any image of miscegenation, any white woman dancing with a black man. And he, this kind of messy colors that you see in Mexican murals or cartoons, you don't see them because he's very aware of what he's doing, how much is a taboo miscegenation. But I think that Alan Locke is one of the great American intellectuals in the Renaissance. The first Du Bois was not in favor of miscegenation. The first Du Bois thought that they wanted freedom for everything. It was not necessary to speak about rights of marriage because they didn't want to marry outside blacks. That's what he thought. But then he changes his mind. Then my colleague Daly has recently finished a book in which she thinks that the civil rights in the 40s wanted to have freedom of marriage, that the black secretly, African-American intellectuals and activists were secretly fighting for freedom for marriage, but couldn't say it because the sexual myth of the African-American man again and raping of the white woman was so strong that they couldn't say. I don't believe that. I don't think that it was a strategy or not. I don't think it was an agenda to finish with miscegenation laws. It was about freedom. But this promestizaje, pro-miscegenation, moved people to study Mexico a lot, and they were looking for Mexico because what will happen? And many realized that maybe the solution, and we need to be careful, to be clear that if we were able to go to this promiscuity a la Mexican, in the long run, maybe it will work. Of course, not all African Americans and not white was in favor of that. But now in the last 10 years, the American historiography is studying a lot of miscegenation. Pascoe is one, Daly is another one. People are really studying this, and maybe to put Covarrubias, Locke, Du Bois on that framework will help Ramiro to center the paper. And Professor Canizares, I ought to leave because it's raining and I have to cross campus.
Thanks, Mauricio. I appreciate it. And so that's
very, very quickly in terms of with the time we have left, Rodrigo, in terms of turning this into something that would be publishable, I think the 7 years that he's in Harlem is part of it. Keep the temporal time framing for the article short, but definitely getting back to Langston Hughes, when you read the first volume of Arnold Rampersad's two volumes, you know, Langston went to Toluca, Mexico, which is very mountainous, very cold, with his father when he was 17. And that's his introduction. And Rampersad says, you know, the first trip to Mexico was a dull horror, right? He doesn't get along with his father. He ends up in Mexico City with anemia, right? And they think that he's might die, right? But he's gonna fall in love with aspects of Mexico City. And it'll be interesting for you to sort of do a parallel with how, you know, sort of Langston Hughes goes into Mexico with his father. There's a point where his father is just giving him 10 pesos a ration and he's not eating well. I mean, it's a real story. I mean, Langston Hughes is this hugely important figure. And I think what you're doing is showing us, if we do it as a triptych, Hughes and Locke and Miguel, just for the article, all of those sentiments are overlapping. And I agree with what professor who just had to leave, Tenorio, was saying vis-a-vis, for an article, all of this is too big. For a book, it's not. It's actually not, you know? And I think that, you know, and even, you know, he was using this word miscegenation. What people wanted was citizenship and dignity, but certainly people were interracially marrying even in the 19th century. But, you know, Jane Daly, his colleague at UChicago, has the new book on just, you know, sexual danger and the civil rights movement. And white supremacists made interracial cisgender sex between black men and white women all, right? They utilized that in the context of violence and policy but I think it was never at the forefront, but it was always going to be one of the reverberations of ending racism was going to be that people or that kind of systemic violent racism, people were going to be able to intermarry. But was it like, you know, at the forefront? No, it was going to be part of the supply chain if things got transformed. But again, Hughes in Mexico is really big, and it's all right here. And there is going to be letters and correspondence, you know? And so two of the books that can help you flesh out the biographical part for Hughes and Elaine Locke, besides going to the archives, are the volume one of Rampersad, I Too Sing America, and the Elaine Locke, The New Negro biography, which is, you know, major. But I think if you keep it within the temporal time frame of when Miguel is in Harlem, it lets you do all kinds of exciting things, and then you leave. And I think it's a good idea, the idea of the essay, the 3 or 4 page sort of conclusion about what this means for a larger project. So I think that I would reduce it to those sort of the time he spends in Harlem, but flesh out Langston in Mexico more for us, because it's extremely fascinating and it connects with a lot of what you're trying to do in the piece.
Thank you so much. The book actually mentions Covarrubias, the Stuart biography.
Yes.
And it says something very puzzling to me that Locke met Covarrubias and they were kind of awkward. I think he was very awkward in general, but Stuart says that he considered Covarrubias a new Negro, like one, yes, one of them, like he totally incorporated him, which is something completely different from what I've read in other books that,
yes,
that Locke kind of struggled against Covarrubias. He didn't like the Vanity Fair kind of celebrity thing he was doing, but he was so famous that he kind of had to let it slide into the anthology because it was like a big, it would be a big hole if he wasn't there. That's the other argument. I don't know which one is the one I'm inclined to accept.
I think it's a combination. I mean, I think Elaine Locke didn't necessarily like a bunch of people, including people like Du Bois and Locke, more tolerated each other and liked the symbolism of each other, right? And I think that's what Elaine, 4'11", gay at a time where that is not accepted. So this, you know, this really brilliant intellectual, but also, you know, Elaine Locke was an elitist, as you know, and somebody who on some levels never felt people he met quite measured up. You know, and you could say that's a defense mechanism too, right? But they're similar in the sense of him and Miguel, in the sense that they're both polyglots, they're both very good at multiple things. They both sort of travelers, but certainly Elaine Locke is, he's the elitist of the elites. I would say Elaine Locke in his own way is more of an elitist than Du Bois. Which is saying something.
it is indeed. Adela.
I'm just going to reiterate that any path you take is okay, insofar as if the article has a perspective, right? In my own reading, the easiest way to do this would be to center in the images, in the drawings, in the caricatures, trace their background, read them, but then use them instrumentally to actually map out the debates within the Harlem Renaissance between Locke and Du Bois. That would be very, very original because, you know, like these debates have been going on like anecdotally about how they encounter each other. But if you use the semiotics of these images, not only the way you could read them or the background you could get about them, but how they were interpreted by these intellectuals, it's going to tell you a lot about the power of images to trigger debates on something else. You see, so this is why I think it could be very important that you situate them, not only semiotically, but also in their circulation and in the reception field, you know, how they were. So I think this could make a very roundup article with a perspective and with a project to see ahead.
I wanted to show, oh, I cannot do it again, Courtney. I am locked out of sharing. Are you there, Courtney?
Sorry, yeah. So you're not able to share?
No, I cannot share again.
Can you try it again?
Okay, no, I can't.
So
you know, I think there was a time, Courtney, that Professor...
Okay, now I can, sorry. So I just wanted to show this, briefly, this image of okay, it's not available. Why? Sorry.
Yeah.
See, here it is. It is the Covarrubias is right next to Rivera, and the wife Rosa, it's to your left, and then Frida is right next to Covarrubias. And what is striking about this image is, well, I mean, the issue of gender, and the empresario who's in the middle, the Nicolas Murray guy whose papers are here in our Ransom Library. But what is striking about this image is the blatant use of understanding of the language of exoticism and ethnography for commercial projects, so that the image, the analysis of images and identities here that are being played out in the Harlem Renaissance and in Mexico, it's also about the power of the media in transforming images, in transforming perceptions. So it's film, it's the use of advertisement as well. So how to bring that into your analysis? That so kind of this deliberate instrumentalization of images, particularly in the case of Covarrubias, as an advertisement, a empresario with no completely separate from identity, as instrumentalization of ethnography and archaeology for in this case transformation of cultural perception. And I think it's in Du Bois as well.
Yes, I think it's something Professor Pineda Franco mentioned, that this commodification of Covarrubias is an instance of a larger commodification of ethnography and anthropology as both to the consumer world, but in the case I'm trying to do research on is the state also participates in this commodification of ethnographic things, of ethnographic kind of ways of seeing, which are at the end displayed, I think, in the Museum of Anthropology in Mexico. There's a very curious story. Carlos Chavez and Covarrubias once approached Walt Disney with a project. This comes in the article Professor Pineda suggested in her comments. They approached the Walt Disney with a kind of an idea of an ethnographic Fantasia 2000 kind of movie. Covarrubias would do the drawings and Carlos Chavez the music. It would have been a wonderful thing, but it would have the same issues and shortcomings that I think Los Tres Caballeros has. Like it would be part of this commodification of the exotic Mexico, the exotic, the Tehuana, Oaxaca, all this, the Jarabe Tapatío, all these things for US audiences and for a cosmopolitan kind of consumer population. So yes, there's that dimension. I would just like to look at how the state, the Mexican state, well, Professor Tenorio doesn't like the phrase, the Mexican kind of political culture is also engaging in this commodification of ethnography.
We are running out of time. We have two final questions about illustrations. Professor Garfield says, it seems like you need a broader discussion of the history of illustration to put Covarrubias' craft in larger context. And he offers a book for you to look up. And then Natalie says, I found an interesting that many expressed concern that cartoons and illustrations could be denigrating caricatures. Very interesting. Are there assumptions about the possibilities and limits of visual representations in particular that run through some of these debates? Do you know if photography was considered capable of representing blackness in a different way?
I know very little about it. I've been looking into photography as a political problem in science. And I know, for example, that Frederick Douglass thought photography had a redemption, like a the power to for the subject to represent herself through photography, which made of the camera kind of the biggest revolutionary instrument ever. But I think by the 1920s, photography is also becoming this kind of very bleak look into exotic populations. So the way Branislav Malinowski and other ethnographers kind of staged their photographs and became kind of a trope in ethnographies to have these pictures there, they became like even more anonymous types than the ones Covarrubias is kind of using. As I said, Rosa Rolando, Miguel's wife, was, as Professor Pineda also said, she was like a full character on her own. She was a great dancer, a photographer. She was trained by Edward Weston and Antina Modotti, no less. And she took wonderful pictures that appear at the end of Covarrubias' books. And in some of these pictures, Covarrubias appears with a camera in hand. And I've never been able to trace in the archive which are Rosa's pictures and which are Miguel's. So I know they didn't hate photography or thought it was like a demeaning aesthetic per se, but I think Covarrubias, both for commercial interest and for kind of a political approach that I'm trying to unpack, he was using his drawings.
Well, thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, Professor Pineda Franco, Professor Joseph, Professor Flores, Corny, Ashley, Rodrigo, everyone, for your participation, your willingness to engage in a conversation, and help Rodrigo improve his essay. Next week, we'll have our last webinar on a student's paper. You are all invited. Okay, thank you. It's here by Haley Schroer. They have always worn Spanish clothes, indigenous elites and sumptuary legislation in 17th century in Spain. We'll have, so far we have three confirmed participants, that the participants are not on the list here in the events webpage, but they are Jane Mangan, Professor Mangan, specialist on 16th and 17th century Potosí. The other two are David Tavares, professor at Vassar College on the history of indigenous elites and indigenous letter city in particularly Oaxaca, but also central Mexico. And Professor Alex Hidalgo at the University of Texas Catholic University, and specialist on indigenous mapping on 17th century Mexica, Oaxaca as well. We'll be soon putting their names in the schedule, in the calendar. Well, thank you, and I'll see you next week.